I'm good.
I mean the radio.
Oh, I really can't listen to a lot of that, but I just keep it on and I kind of keep the sound off, so but I've been keeping it on
Me
for
too.
everyone.
Okay, that's the main thing.
Thanks, Rachel.
Yeah.
Sweet, thanks a lot.
Oh, of course. Thank you for doing what you're doing. So grateful.
That's good feeling. Somebody's breathing in the mic.
I think it's Jackie. Your mic is doing something.
How did you know it was me?
Because it lights up when their sounds come through.
And Frank has a definite heavy breathing sound.
Yes, he does.
Yeah.
At 7 o'clock, at the stellar hour, my son-in-law is going to come over for a healing.
Yeah, I saw that.
Yeah, that'll be a perfect opportunity to discuss the use of water, healing water, and how to program water and things like that. So that'll be a great lead-in. Yeah, I'm interested to see how well this works.
Yeah, me too. I appreciate everybody being willing to do this.
I'm not hearing you so well, Jackie.
Oh, God. It's my iPad. I don't know what to do.
It's making all kinds of noises, too.
Is that any better?
Not yet.
Not really. And it's making a lot of feedback. Oh, wait, that's better. Whatever you just did.
Turn your volume up, Jackie.
I did.
Oh, oh that you're better. Whatever you just did, it's better.
Okay.
Sounds like you're kicking it around the floor.
Or she's got a balloon there.
Oh my God! All right, I'm going to put my microphone on mute.
Okay.
Does anyone have any suggestions for this show?
Nope. Sorry.
That was not a good one.
Talk about my heavy breathing.
I'm not sure if today's
Teresa's,
a good time to talk about it, but at one time you wanted to bring up breathing exercises. You said you had a few good ones. Not that today's the day, but in the near future, because I think everyone could think about it, and maybe they all have different ways of getting to a good breath.
I don't think that was my suggestion. Who made that suggestion?
Oh, a couple months ago we talked about it.
Okay.
I think Rich said something the other day, and that he had a CD of Andrew Wiles about all about breathing.
Oh, that was it. Yeah.
Yeah, there was something, though, Frank, as you were saying, Teresa wanted done, and I can't recall what it was.
Well, it has to do with social media and how many kids are getting into trouble.
Oh, yes. In fact, a lot came up for me around that because I have a friend who's going through stuff. Around the children would be really good because something else came up around my friend's little boy where these – teachers now feel that it's okay just to put a computer in front of them and they teach them in front of a screen when their brains are still young and developing. And they don't understand what this is actually doing to the kids. And one mom is trying to kind of hold the light for these kids, especially these super sensitive children. There's a lot going on with that.
Okay. Yeah, bring all that up and talk about it when we get into it.
Okay. Yeah, what she talked about the social media with the kids. Oh, yeah, and the tweak. What I say, I don't know all that terminology. Tweaking or something. What is the word?
I don't remember what it is either. But they talk to each other, tweeting.
Tweeting, yeah, and they do those selfies. They call them selfies, and they're committing suicide. And yeah.
Well, I got some information this afternoon on that. It came back into my mind, so there are some things we can do about that. We'll let it develop. Stephen will come in probably and do that.
Yeah, sitting down and having people realize that we need to get back, as you say, into dominion. You know, what is it? They shall have dominion over. And they're confusing dominion with domination.
And it's turning people away from nature, and you need to connect in with nature. It's like these young kids just need that childhood and to play out in nature. And there is a balance with this technology. It's not all about this technology.
Well, that's what I think people don't understand, is that our bodies are of this earth.
Yeah.
You know, granted, we are of the stars, our souls especially, but these bodies have been here made from this earth for how many years? And so we do have the pull and pull with Mother Nature, because that is who our mother really is.
Yes. That's right.
Mm-hmm. We're in the moon sign of Gemini right now. And so this is a good time to discuss something like this, because we can look at both sides of any situation and see all aspects of it. So this would be good. It's a very positive sign, though, in Gemini. Everything, there's only three direct aspects, and they're all very positive and active, and it feels like it, doesn't it? Everything feels good.
It does. It feels wonderfully good. But when it feels this good, this is when we do need to work, when people are feeling good, instead of like me, I feel like I'm just drunk on this good feeling, so I don't want to do anything.
Well, we're not getting many on tonight.
Well, Frank, this is Dent, and I heard that VP is getting the courts to let them off the hook for all the damage they did in the Gulf, and the Gulf's still suffering terribly from all that oil and all the things that they sprayed to break up the oil. And I don't know if there's anything we can do, but that was a concern for me, because I, you know, the Gulf is such a beautiful place.
Well, yeah, there's things we can do. Definitely, always we can work with the devas and give them energy and direction and pull in lots of galactic energy to help and direct that to them. Hello, Mike. What's new?
Hey, Frank. I'm just getting set up. I'm here, you know, I'm just kind of taking care of things. So I sent you an email earlier. We can talk about that later or tomorrow. And I, that Cade of Gaia recording is really amazing. Babylon has fallen. This guy basically is making there is no jurisdiction except for the crown and us self-governing men and women. And obviously we're self-governing men and women. So the whole thing is in the process of just little by little of the ridiculousness of it, you know, occurring to us all. So I was really profoundly overcome by it, listening to it last night in the middle of the night. I went through a period of dark despair, and then that just happened to be the listening that I had downloaded for middle of the night when I couldn't sleep. I think there's no coincidence. So I got to finish getting organized here, and I'll be lurking in the background for a while.
Okay. There's JP.
Hello, hello. Is it yourself? There we go.
Welcome to Healings and Meditations with Frank Jordan and the Earth Mind Think Tank Group. We take requests for healings in the second hour. Hang on a second. You can call in on 1-775-773-3431 in the second hour. Or just use the chat room. We've fixed them now. Name of the person, the location, and the position of the person you see. Bad timing. You're listening to Wolf Spirit Radio. October 12th, 2014. Healings and meditations with Frank Jordan and the Earth Healers Universal Mind Radio Morphic Resonance Group. Hello, Frank. How are you?
Oh, I'm fine. And it's nice to hear your voice again and see you're up and perky and healthy today. So
yes, I've been consuming shungite. Having good fun with it.
Yeah, I've been playing with shungite this week since Diane brought it up on your show. And are they going to be doing that again? Will they be running that show again?
I'm sure I can see it, find it for you in the archive.
Yeah, well, I listened to it, to both shows, actually. Very interesting, about 4 hours worth. That stimulated me to start experimenting with it to see what the actual features are of it that we
excellent.
Can
improve. I'd be interested in your vision of this.
Well, I already have some feedback on it, but I want to really prove it out before I jump into the fray with them. You know, it's pretty easy to apply a lot of attributes to things just because we want them to work that way. But the real test is putting it to work and see if you can get a definite energetic response and sensation. And again, like my little five levels of truth is concerned, does it do something? Can you repeat it? Can you teach it to others? And is it worth doing anyway? And does it do no harm? So I think that I would like to encourage the members of the group and anyone else out there that's listening who's been introduced to shungite to experiment with it, see what this stuff will do, and give us feedback. It's not enough just to rely on information you get from others, because we can listen to things all day and it doesn't mean a thing. But if we can actually internalize it and make it work for us, and then from proven experience, pass it forward, then we know it's beneficial and is worth promoting. And there was certainly a lot of good information came up with Nancy and Diane and Walt Silva. And I can see the potential of incorporating shungite in some of his apparatuses. But let's see what it does first. Let's everyone play with their shungite and see what it can do with it. Have you had any direct responses with it, JP?
Oh, yeah, plenty. I mean, for one, I have a piece around my neck. It's a triangle. It's about an inch and a half on a side and about a quarter of an inch thick. It's a lovely, nice chunk. And sometimes I'll say, "Hey, try this." And when I take it off, it feels like, "Oh no, give it back to me." That it has a field of energy that is, it kind of calms the soup around you.
Mm-hmm.
The soup that is kind of forever swishing around that we can't see, that we can't perceive, but has an irritating effect on us. And what it's like the old fashioned tone control, which basically takes off the treble, makes your voice sound more like this. You see, so it calms things down for me. It's a calmer, cooler is another word for it. It's cool in that it takes away excess heat, but it's not cold. It's cool.
Mm-hmm. Well, Diane sent me two pieces. One is actually looks like an egg that someone created, and then another little flat piece with a little nipple in it that you set the egg in. And I use the flat piece in my left hand and the egg in my right hand. I just did it when you began talking about it. And you can definitely feel that expansion of energy. And what I'm looking for is how much it can be programmed and what, you know, like a crystal is, and if it has more power than a crystal does or not. And because we can feel crystals too, or any crystalline mineral that is capable of holding energy. And it is a fascinating thing. So let's play with it this week, and perhaps next week or later we can get Diane and Walt on and possibly Nancy to discuss it with our findings. Does everyone out there have a piece of shungite? I think Diane tried to send a piece to everyone, didn't she? In the group?
I don't have one.
I don't have one either.
I don't have one either.
We don't have any either, but...
Okay. Well, I'm sorry. I'm not even sure how you'd access and find any of it. Do you, JP?
Oh, right. Well, if anybody can get hold of Nancy, Nancy Hopkins, she's my co-host. She was like on 10 minutes ago. And she can supply you. She's in Florida and has probably the biggest pile of shungite in America. She used to be a mineral trader, and she like went around and bought loads of shungite, all sizes, all forms. You know, you can, you know, from 2 pound size to little pieces. So cosmicreality.net, and get in touch and say you're from the Frank Jordan Healing Group, and I'm sure she'll put some interesting things your way. It's not expensive. It's very, very affordable.
Okay, that's good. All right. Well,
Frank,
yeah.
This is Mike, just quick. I have a Walt device, you know, it's custom designed spiral with shungite in the middle, and which I'm programming to, work on my health condition primarily, but my health and my ability to access subtle energies. And I've noticed initial encouraging responses. So I'll chime in whenever the discussion happens.
Well, that's exactly what I'm doing with it too. I'm working on some of my physiological problems, and just really closely observing the response and doing it like a scientist would, you know, because I am basically a scientist. And so we'll have a report on this weekly as we go along. It might be a good way to begin the shows, is everybody give a report. So everyone contact Nancy and get a piece of this stuff. Or Diane. I'm sure Diane may have it also. And let's make a study of this. It'd be a good project. Okay.
One of the people that are in town that I get my crystals from had a whole shipment, had a really nice shipment of different sizes. And I bought a string of round beads, and I haven't gotten to it yet, but I'm going to make a bracelet to wear. And I got about 6 pieces of about 1 by 1/2 inch pieces. And I've been putting it in my water bottles and using it in my drinking water.
Can you tell a taste of difference or feel any response?
I think it's been helping my depression and my fear, you know, but I really haven't tuned into it that much. But I had a headache the other day, and I started, okay, fine, I need to drink water, and it went away. So, but
you know, Susan, a way to test it is to not drink it for 1 day and see.
Okay.
Well, the problem here is the placebo effect. If we're expecting something to happen, the body automatically accepts that it can happen. So that's why they do the double-blind studies and whatnot in science to alleviate that. So anyway, if it works, wonderful.
But I did also program it with the other bottles, my other bottles of water that I had that I didn't have it in. I just programmed them all to get rid of all the nasty stuff in the water and purify it.
Jackie, if we're going to put Kyle on a water regimen, a charged water regimen to help his kidney dialysis and his vision and whatever problems that you, this might be an excellent thing to do. One of the things I tell people anyway when we're working with water is to charge crystals. Put your intent in crystals and put the crystal in the water so it maintains the energy and directs it to what we want it, our intent is. So we'll talk about that during the healing part of the program.
And possibly we'll use shungite if I get some shungite.
Yeah, that's my suggestion.
Okay.
Do you know what we can do is use some bottles with crystal in it, quartz crystal, and some with shungite, and see if he can feel any response. And don't tell him which is which.
Okay, are you wanting me to go ahead and have some quartz crystals for us to put energy into tonight?
Excellent idea.
I have a few small ones I could use.
Mm-hmm. Doesn't take a huge one.
And that'll go in the water.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And you understand how to...
You put it in front of the speaker or something.
Can I put the crystal in front of the speaker? Is that what you said?
Well, possibly, or just hold it in your hand because you're in direct resonance with us anyway as we're doing this work.
Yeah.
So I think that could possibly do it also.
Okay.
In fact, I would suggest that because you are a better receiver than what the electromagnetic system is.
Okay. All right. Well, I think I have three I could use. For three of the bottles. And we'll just actually put it in the water. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay.
Afterward.
All right.
Maybe Dent has some, too, if he's handy there.
I've got a couple of crystals, but I don't have any quartz. The quartz are too big to put in the water bottles. So. Mm-hmm.
The ones I have are small, little pointed ones I can use.
We can get some because we live nearby a really big crystal place here that has tons of them. We can just go by them and pick up some.
Okay. Yeah, you can program them yourself once you download the program we'll instill in you.
Right.
Of how to work with dialysis and kidney conditions. Okay. All right, let's go to Teresa, and what she suggested is a good program to work with tonight, which is working with the social media, and give us some examples, Teresa, of what you understand about it and what's happening, and what can we'll get into what we can do directly to help these problems. So let's get a good discussion going between everyone here. And then towards the end of the program, we'll do the earth mind clearing on whatever you bring up.
Mm-hmm. Hi, everyone. This is Teresa. I am visiting family in near Ottawa. And there was a group of us sitting around the table. And two of them were teachers talking about social media, meaning Facebook and so on. And there were young teenagers also sitting around the table, and the discussion was about how fast social media can distribute information around an entire community. And the example was there are kids, young girls who are doing selfies or self photographs of themselves naked and then sending it to their boyfriend. And then the element of trust there is, oh, well, my boyfriend wouldn't dream of sharing it with anybody, so he does. And they're using them like trading cards, and to the point where there was one young 29-year-old who was actually caught and arrested for child porn because he had so many. And kids are being really hurt by this. And another example was my daughter-in-law, who's a teacher. She said that in the classroom, she said it was just a normal morning teaching, and all of a sudden the room just exploded into tears and a real raucous. And one of the girls in the room had an abortion, and she told one person, and it spread everywhere. And so everybody in that entire school knows what happened. And my daughter-in-law said since the beginning of the year of September term, there's already been, I think she said, 7 or 9 attempted suicides of young girls. And it's lightning speed information that is extremely private. And of course with any young person, it just seems that our emotions at that age seem to be extremely magnified and hypersensitive, and they're children who are making wrong choices, and they don't have filters yet on how to deal with that type of information. And to someone who's passing on, it's like a treasure hunt, and you find something, you want to show it to someone else. So there isn't the depth of maturity there. And it is probably wherever there are youth with, or immature adults with social media, it can be very harmful and very explosive. I also heard on the other side of it, in mid-Canada, there was a young girl who was being bullied via the social media, where another girl told her, go and kill yourself. And the girl's response to that was, the next day she just took a bag full of sticky notes that she spent the entire evening writing comments about how wonderful you are. And she put all these sticky notes all over the lockers, all over the school, you know, little affirmations about how wonderful we really are. And apparently the principal thought better of it, and it's declared it. It was wasteful and litter. And then the whole town caught on in the whole town. And so he thought better of it after he realized that it was a lot deeper than he had reacted to. And the whole community came out and supported it. And he even declared that a certain day, last week I think it was sticker affirmation day or something like that. And so it was really quite a wonderful solution to something, and heighten awareness and bring right choice to children and young adults and to whole communities. So
and
I think
a young person started that, Teresa?
Yeah, the same girl that had the hate, the go kill yourself comment too. She was the one who actually
bless her
did
heart.
That. I agree. Very, very powerful. So it's something that was completely outside my world until this weekend when, I mean, there were 20 of us around a dinner table last night, because in Canada it's our Thanksgiving. And there were around the table, there were, I think, eight youngsters here. So it was really exciting to be with them and to share their insights and how they feel about that. So that's what my new discovery this weekend.
Well, there's nothing new about it. Bullying has been going on from the time they've been teenagers, I guess. And it's a shame, because what they're really trying to do is find their own self-worth, their self-identity. And if they have low self-worth from abuse or poor programming at home or something, or in their experiences, they test this out on others by projecting it on others to see what their response will be. And if the response is positive, such as the girl you just mentioned, then that nullifies it. If instead it's the bullying or domination is downloaded and the person is made subjective and it contributes to their self-worth, then it's just like the dominator is downloading and releasing the stress of her own lack of self-worth on the other person. And it becomes a habitual thing that becomes a very poor standard of creativity for life out there. If you have to denigrate or downgrade or make someone else feel bad in order to feel good about yourself, and that's not a very good social thing to bring into the world. Certainly nothing to bring into a relationship, because it would be instant battle. Let's have some more feedback on things of this nature. Yvonne, you're a psychiatrist and have worked with abused children. Do you have anything to comment on this issue?
Hello, everyone. Nothing that really comes to mind. It's a big, yeah, it's always so much bigger than it looks. I suppose what comes to mind is that, you know, the gift of devastation is that when we are devastated, we look for the light and we go to an equal and opposite amount of light. So in my experience, I don't, you know, look at these devastating experiences with a limited view. I see them that, you know, that they're part of the soul's journey for awakening and growing into greater depths of love and experience. So to me, it's, you know, having things available so that, you know, when people are devastated, there's somewhere or someone or something that they can reach out to. So I think, yeah, you know, the more we have community awareness and speaking about these things and, you know, any sort of, you know, helpful, you know, situations that are set up that are in service and love, you know, we find our way. Because I know when I've been in these terrible, supposedly, situations, you know, there's been a transformation to a greater light, because there is free will. And I always like to remember that, you know, in everybody's journey, we will come to that devastation and dark soul, and then there's free will, you know. So then we're either 100% ready for something else, or we're not. And we're seeing that very strongly now within the world. You know, to me, even the Ebola is a great opportunity for people to choose something else, to say, no, that can't be all there is. There has to be something else, and to reach. And if they reach, that something else is there instantly. So I guess I'm in service to having more solutions there, and living and being the solution, being in the solution and not the problem. So always when people come to me, always keep my foot in the eternal. I mean, I totally respect and am loving, you know, in the impermanent problem and situation that we find ourselves in, but I'm always got another foot in the eternal, where there's nothing that's needed to be healed, where, you know, bliss and love go forever, and that's who we really are. So thank you. That's all that comes to mind to share.
I think probably the biggest problem there is if there's no education facilities, either through the parents or the schools or any other association, religious or spiritual, whatever, that can help these kids to find the light, to see the positive aspect of, or to see any positive demonstration of the light and the right choices and the potentials that we all have. If they don't have that, it's so easy for them to get submersed in the, into the domination realm, and once they're there, it's really difficult to climb back out of that again. And your indication is that each person has to do it alone. But if they don't have some guidance of some kind to help them, to give them a direction, how, it's pretty difficult to climb out of the pit.
Well, a chance
in
the
community. Do you think that perhaps it's the ones who are doing the bullying and the cyberbullying and all of that who need the help?
That's exactly my experience. It all begins behind the child in the home and in their experiences.
But also, Dr. Yvonne mentioned the community is somewhat to blame for this, what happens, or responsible, let's say, for what happens in the community. And our communities are set up in a terrible way. In such that 4-year-old kids only hang around with 4-year-old kids. That 7-year-old kids only hang around with 7-year-old kids. 13, 14-year-old kids only hang around with people their own age. There are authority figures around them all the time, parents, but they're all busy working, both working at some career or trying to make ends meet. And the kids are all alone in their little schoolrooms with a bunch of other kids their own age. How are they going to really learn anything about life and understand the consequences of how they treat each other and stuff like that? They never teach them that in school. It's all about just getting them ready to go to work for and be a slave.
They learn it on TV, unfortunately.
Exactly. Role models getting tattoos and earrings, and they're all just naked on the stage, dancing around. Miley Cyrus, a little slut, just making all the other girls like be this, emulate the same thing. So they're making these nude photos and spreading them around. And look at all the nude photos they sprung for all these superstars, naked females that are all got nude photos that leak out all over the place. The world's full of a bunch of perverts who just
feel that we need to focus on positive ways to help them. And I agree with everything you're saying, Gary. I have been working for several years in what we call junior youth groups, which are 11 to 14-year-olds. And we do activities. We have discussions. We discuss what's going on in the rest of the world. And every one Sunday a month, and this next Sunday we're going to do it, we go and feed the homeless at the local center. And just, it's an opportunity for each one of us to be of service. Those of us that are aware, and we know that there are young people out there. This is a vulnerable age. It's an opportunity for each of us to reach out and try to get groups of kids to spend time with and give them alternatives. Understanding of the way the world is, because that's exactly what they're exposed to. It's horrible. All the things you named, it's terrible. I've raised two generations of children and went through all of that with them. And, you know, I think it's a good idea to each of us to make this a goal, to work with young people and find ways to do that in our given communities.
Well, my observation is that kids are naturally curious, and they are driven by their biological urges, and the sexual urge is certainly the biggest one that kicks in about in the adolescent period. And if they, there isn't a ready answer for their curiosity supplied by the parents in sexual education and what to do and what not to do, then they're going to explore and experience, and I know this is the main function of these social interactions through the internet and whatnot, is passing along curiosity, satisfying curiosity. What do you know that I don't know? And it's quite easy to be led astray into the negative aspects of sexuality, instead, if you haven't been programmed in the beautiful positive aspects of it.
It's almost like a taboo subject.
Well, it is.
Well, it's more than just sexuality, because these kids are not only just messing around with nude photos, they're actually making suicide pacts with each other and doing weird shit like that, too. It's not just sexual. There's more to it than that.
Well, there you wonder, where does it come into their minds to do this stuff? And i.e., it is the TV. There are TV programs and movies
Yeah, exactly.
That
they're brainwashed.
Write about this. So they put the programming into MK somebody's
Ultra.
Naive mind.
Exactly. The CIA runs the kids in this place. Their mind control stuff. We're all under the influence of that. We've got to get out from under it and start, you know, creating something else.
Well, let's go a little bit deeper now. You're all discussing the dynamics of what's happening out there. Let's look at some potentials of what can be done to change that.
To get back to the true innocence of humanity. And that's what the youth is all about, the true innocence of humanity.
And how do you do that, Kathy?
Have people rediscover themselves within their heart, the spot of love that each and every one of us was graced with when we came into this world. And that was, it is not encouraged to be and to love, to find the love for yourself within yourself and respect.
Well, that's almost like spiritual teaching, isn't it? Not religious, where you're looking outside of yourself for that love, but within, spiritual.
I recently heard a very interesting interview who included Edgar Mitchell, the sixth astronaut on the moon. And he is a very spiritual man. And he started the, amongst other organizations, the Noetics Society. But one of the comments that was made in the interview, and there were several other people, and they were talking about off-planet entities, aliens, whatever you want to title them. And one of the comments that was made that I thought was extremely profound, and I think it may be a way to look at what we're looking at, and that is that there is a fascination with Earthlings because we have, or this was the comment, I'm loosely quoting it, that Earthlings are the only entities that have the ability to create or co-create. And I know that one of the things that with my own experience, I've taught children and young adults and adults, and the creativity part was always one of the vehicles that when they were on that vehicle, they traveled the furthest and the fastest. And I can remember my own experiences in art college, and we were expected to be creative, and it was probably one of the most dynamic experiences in my life, which created a pattern of creativity where you are always problem solving or creating anew for yourself and hopefully for others. And so I can see that as a golden light or a seed that could be planted for young adults and young children.
Along of what you're saying, Teresa, so the perpetrators of the distress, the bulliers, because they feel they have no control of anything at all within themselves at all, that the only way they feel that control is by dominating, downplaying somebody else. And so on how their reaction, that feeds their own sense of control and well-being within them, because they cannot control themselves. They feel that they are able to control somebody else by being mean. Does that make sense?
Sure. And I experience that often myself with being with people who are dominators. And I'm very much aware of them dominating. They may not be aware of that, of themselves, except I gotta win, I gotta win, I gotta win. You know, by putting you down, by saying things that make them feel more dominant. And I have to sit back and be the observer, and at every opportunity I try to bring in or just slide in a comment to help them to rise above that rather than feel attacked by it. And I refuse to feel like I'm the victim. I don't wear victim very well. I don't like it, and I know that that's part of that pattern. So it is an absolute joy to bring in an invitation so that they can rise above that. And I don't, well, from my own experience of people, even in my own family, it's been years and years and years, and I've never conquered it, so to speak, to get them to rise above those nasty comments, let's say, or put downs or whatever. But I know that I've tried to bring them a tiny bit higher, and for a moment they have. And I feel, in a way, that's a triumph, and it's not not my triumph, it's theirs.
Beautiful, so. On how you stated that you invite them, and that's allowing them the free will, and that is so beautiful. I like that.
Thank you.
You, as the observer, when you see someone like those members, family members you're speaking of, putting someone else down or finding fault with someone or seeing less than in someone else, it's always a reflection of what they're actually seeing them in themselves. But if they project it outward, it draws the attention away from how bad that person is who's doing the projection. It puts the projection on someone outside of themselves so that people notice how bad they are, how they feel about themselves. This is one of the things I work on with virtually every person that I do clearing work with. When I go into them and read them, if they've had very much this type of thing of negative self-projection projected at them, which they've internalized, I always feel an energy field over their face. And I call it the facade. And it's a facade that's created by negative self-perception, how you feel about yourself. And that is like a resonance. Your own self-perception, your inner awareness, resonates this energy of lack of self-worth. And it sits right on your face, and so that everyone who looks at you has to actually energetically go through that to see the real you. And if it's bad enough in you, all they get is a reflection from you is that you're a worthless person, that you're not to be qualified as being someone who is beneficial or can help them in any way. And so this is what one of the things that causes our first impressions on people. This is why so many people create a personality, an outward personality they project out around themselves, that becomes their outer facade, and that outer facade is totally different usually than what the inner indwelling soul expression is of the person who is creating that kind of a facade. You see this a lot in people like, well, take movie stars for example. When you see them on the screen, all they're projecting is these wonderful John Wayne personas that can do no wrong, stand up for all the little people, and are absolutely beautiful beings. And so we go for so far as to elect them to public offices and things that they're just totally unqualified to do. And if you get beneath that facade and look at the real person, they're just ordinary people like anybody else. And looking at our own president, for example, right now, everything you see in him is a facade. The real person, if you get inside of him, is really a screwed up, messed up individual. And I don't care what political party you belong to. Most of our leaders are guilty of that. They should all have to have a clearing before they go into office. if we could facilitate that. But anyway, I got off my dissertation a little bit. The realization that what people are projecting out and acting out on others is really just a reflection of what they are within themselves and what they experience. If I can make you feel bad and get somebody else to pick on you also, that makes me superior to you. But just like Catherine was saying, if you don't download that, don't accept it. And what Teresa was saying too, the girl who passed out the sticky notes, if you don't accept that, don't download it, then the other person, the one that's doing the projecting, immediately feels that. And it's kind of like if you don't accept something, it's not a reality. If you hold it outside of yourself and reflect it back to the person, it makes that person realize how stupid they are to have said that about you. Any put down or negativity. So looking at your own family, Teresa, is there an opportunity in that family to, when someone puts somebody else down or some critical comment, criticism and judgmentalness was one of the biggest things. When you observe that, do you neutralize that by expressing what the positive aspect of that person is that's being put down?
Sometimes what I'll do is I'll just state the obvious, and that seems to let all the gas out, so to speak. Mm-hmm. You know, it deflates it immediately, and then there are low chuckles, but I find that is a useful tool. And or I will try to bring in another comment to the person who was attacked, let's say. And I'll tell them how beautiful they really are, mm-hmm. and to ignore that. It's not yours.
But that's energy in the now. Our conversation started with it all being on the internet and cyberbullying.
Mm-hmm.
And so I know that is in the now, but how would you diffuse it that way, Frank?
Well, that's where we're going now. I've just been waiting for one of you to suggest a way to do this. But there is a definite way of how to do that. You recall that when people get together in group mind consciousness, they quickly come, no matter how, if it's just three people, or five people, or 50 people, or 100 people, it doesn't matter what it is, any age group, any level of society, any interaction, they quickly come to a harmony, a commonality of agreement. If anyone entering this group has to simulate that, the group mind intent of reality. And if they don't, they feel left out. They feel purposely excluded. So they do everything they can to adapt and pick up. And this is an instinctive thing. You don't even realize you do it, but you can look into any group of people. And if there's been discussions going on, they'll be formulating a common ground of agreement, no matter what the situation, the group gathering is about. And before they leave, they will have pretty well balance themselves out into agreement that I'm okay, you're okay, because we agree on this way. Now, that agreement can be negative as well as positive. See, if we all agree that we're okay because we're all negative, that's not a good thing either, because anyone else is that has to go negative in order to fit in with them. And I'm thinking about the little cliques and things in high school, particularly among girls, where they feel they get three or four close friends and they're okay in their group. But to be okay and find their own self-worth in this competitive field of young females, particularly females are more competitive than boys ever thought about being, because they have to be okay to the group, in the group, to attract a boy outside of the group. Their polarity balance, and so this is their function is how do they come to an agreement, and what's the level of the agreement going to be? Some of them can be very positive, and some can be very negative. Well, okay, what happens? What really happens now? It isn't just one. There isn't just four in the school that we're doing it. There'll be dozens and dozens of these little associated groups. Now, here's the thing that I noticed one time. When I walked into a high school to do a lecture in a psychology class, I was invited to do a demonstration of healing. And when I walked into that school, it was just like getting hit, just being almost overwhelmed with energy. And I was just shocked because the pervasive frequency of the energy there was sexual. It was very low-level consciousness. And if it's sexual energy, then they're automatically focused in their low selves. And the function of the teacher in society is to try to domesticate them, bring them up into their high selves, so they're thinking just like you people have been talking and thinking tonight about positive ways of doing things. But it's got to be a horror for a teacher to try to keep their attention up out of the sexuality in a high enough level to listen to the teacher trying to give them domestication, so to speak, domesticating to be humans instead of animals. Anyway, this is the point I'm coming to right now to answer your question, Teresa. All of that resonance from these people, these kids, are resonating right down into Earth mind. And there can, the following year, a new group of kids could come in from all different directions, freshmen had never been in that high school before, could walk in there. And within hours, the same thing is occurring because the instinctive consciousness is resonating right up out of Earth's mind into these kids that this is the way life is. This is what we have to do. This is how we function as humans. This is how we compete. This is how we attract a mate. This is how we get along in the world or and survive or don't. And so we have to go beneath the dynamics to what really happens. Is that it's just an automatic programming thing that these schools do out there to kids. And it's low self negative programming. It's just basic. It's instinctive to them by the time they get that move out of grade school into high school. It's a shift upward to different social structure, strata, and it occurs. Now, Catherine was talking about bringing people back to the pure purity of consciousness of little children. How do you do that? Well, every one of these kids, these young adults, has had those few moments of being the pure little child. And then, depending on what their social programming is at home, they get into adapting and being programmed into being human and being a competitive human, a survivalist and human. And that's where the indwelling soul begins to come in about 4 or 5 years of age, as the parents trying to domesticate these kids to be human instead of animals. The high self begins to interact and send down messages from the mountaintop to them, so they do have opportunity to make right choice. Now, as they get older, they become more and more subjective to the outer influences. And when you get something like these social media prompters, things that they hold in their hands and can't get along without, they're creating a group mind consciousness every day and maintaining that negativity, that sexuality, the base consciousness of low animal consciousness, even while they're having to learn to be high humans. So how do you, what do you do here? Well, you do exactly the same thing you would do if you were going beneath a city that's been programmed for 1,000 years, one half of the city fighting the other half, ongoing war just for control and survival. You go underneath the city and you deprogram Earth mind of that instinctive survival quality and characteristic, and reprogram it to stimulate people to make the right choice of being that beautiful, innocent child again. And just like Jesus said, you all have to become his children and, you know, to enter the kingdom of God. That's what he was talking about. The kingdom of God simply being the high level of humanity where we can all be in dominion. Does that make sense?
Wonderfully so.
Yes.
Absolutely. All right, how do we do it? Well, I'll tell you how we do it. We go into group mind through Wolf Spirit Radio and through the intent of, I hope, thousands or hundred thousands of people out there that are listening to us now. Close your eyes. Take your awareness up into your foreheads. And first of all, stop in the will center, the indwelling soul center of every living human, no matter what their age is. This is where the soul indwells. And this is where it starts. No matter what the society, the religion, unify it. Unify it in high self-perception. And reach around the world. And we do this more and more in our meditations as we unify world consciousness in dominion. And that in dominion, the high self has all the positive expressions of human potential. The low self has all the negative potentials and expression of being an animal human. So the first thing we do is soothe the indwelling soul, is stimulate everyone to lift their eyebrows, to be up in dominion, to stay above the heart level. As long as you got your eyebrows up, your attention is focused on your forehead, you're in high self. You can't think about anything sexual, or you can't respond to these negative influences. Now that's where it starts, is having a commonality of everyone in the world wanting to be in their high selves instead of operating out of their low selves. Now, take that awareness, that unified field, a step backward into the psychic center. And here we can communicate with every living person on earth. We're focused on the young people now, high school age and college age. Extend out to them that high will intent to be high human, to be in dominion, to make right choice to be operating out of the high self into the low self. Now feel your hands heating up with the polarity that's coming through from the galactic center, because this is a manifestation of a polarity form that we're creating. The polarity form of intent to be high human. It's a level of consciousness. Now, open your foreheads and bring in the photon flow of energy to empower your desire and will and intent. with higher frequencies of energy, so that every human in the world is inspired, particularly the teenagers and kids, to think higher, to make right choice, to know when they're doing something wrong, and to react positively. Feel the photon energy just expand your own intent outward in a wave of consciousness around the world as we stimulate the photon receptors in every human to respond to these higher potentials and frequencies. Now holding that, use the group mind consciousness of the world to look downward within themselves, below the heart, and at the heart center, let's send another wave around of unifying love around the world, unify the spirit center. The spirit center that is fueled with love. Now look downward. You're in the hearts and minds of every living person on earth. Now look downward into the low self and how it has been subjugated to be an animal, an intelligent animal, by the opposition force that is focused on sexuality and low self addictions, sensuality, domination, cruelty, lack of self-worth, and send a wave of energy down into earth mind, into earth mind to clear and release from every assembly, every high school, every college, every church, every place where people organize and gather. Send this resonance down in to earth mind so the consciousness will shift, the instinctive driving consciousness will shift from domination to dominion. So the first thoughts that prompt them will be thoughts of love and empowerment. And just carry all this domination force energy down into the earth center where it's turned into matter unorganized. Now bring in from the photon belt, bring in a tremendous flow and power of energy now, because this is just really beginning to intensify. And use it to drive domination forces downward and into the center of the earth. And now let that resonance continue as you bring your awareness back up into your high self, into your psychic centers. And through your psychic center, you send the message out to every educator, every parent, every priest or preacher, anyone who deals with group mind consciousness of people. Send the message to them. You don't heal domination by meeting it head on. You go beneath the dynamics of whatever it's creating and shift the consciousness beneath it the consciousness that supports the expression of all living humans. And so it is. And that, my friends, is how you do it. Shall we take a break?
With pleasure.
That was amazing, Frank. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Thank you.
Down to Gonky Park, listening to the wind of change. August summer night, soldiers passing by, listening to the wind of change. We could be so close, like brothers. The future's in the air, can feel it everywhere, blowing with the wind of change. Thank you.
Welcome back to Healings and Meditations with Frank Jordan and the Earth Healers Group. Frank, you're back.
Yep, I'm here.
Lovely. That tune, that's my, you know, I don't know if you saw The Men Who Stare at Goats. They have a tune by Boston, More Than a Feeling. This is my remote viewing tune.
Mm-hmm.
It's a wonderful one to just kind of explore the universe in.
Mm-hmm. Very nice. Well, I have to shift, and I think we all do now, from healing the planet to healing individuals. So we'll step back from Stephen and give Francis a few moments to come forward, because Francis is the one who's been the healer for 30 years, and we draw a lot on his information and experiences in our healing work. So, Jackie, is Kent with you?
He's not here yet, Frank. I have a healing request, though, from a lady in Florence, Oregon. She has a pinched nerve in her back. Her name is Bethany, and she's responsible for a lot of people, and she helps and works with a lot of people. And it really is inhibiting her ability to do her help type of work. So,
all right, is it a lumbar vertebrae?
I tried to get that information, but I wasn't able to. I'm not sure exactly where it's located on her back.
That's what I'm picking up. All right. Bethany, is there a chance she'd be listening?
Yes, there is. I'm hoping she is.
Bethany, I'm picking up you have a pinch in your at the mid-level of your lumbar vertebrae. It just causes by the compression, sometimes from overflexure of those vertebrae because of carrying excess weight and makes you arch your back and to carry the weight on your coming. I'm not saying that's you. I'm saying this for everyone else who might be identifying with this. If you have any kind of lower back, lumbar back compression or lumbar compression now, just tune into us. Just feel the resonance coming directly out now through our hands, through the galactic flow. And if you have any of these particular problems, just hold your hands about 10 inches apart. And you can do this to yourself. Visualize your own lumbar as though you were standing behind yourself. And feel the polarity flow between your hands. Our intent is to strengthen the disc, literally pump the disc up again back into its normal condition. And the way I do that is I bring in a spiraling energy that flows from the right side to the left behind, which would be clockwise looking down at it if you're looking from above. This is a chartreuse green energy, which is a general healing color. And we're focusing on Bethany's back at the moment, but everyone out there who has back problems can do this. We see that circulation of energy. It's just like dissolving that disc or any other disc that may have a problem. And the flow coming in rebuilds the disc, brings the positive polarity energy form back into the disc, brings it up in the right and perfect condition through the power of the Christ within us. we see these discs in their perfect and normal condition. Just takes a few moments, and this is an incredible healing tool because it's one that works 95% of the time. Now, you have the polarity of the positive male right hand intent that holds the form. Now you need to wrap around it the left hand energy in a spiral that goes counterclockwise looking down at it, which is the negative polarity. So we put a spiraling, this is a kind of a white energy. And between the two, the new disc is formed and sets up quite nicely. The beauty of this procedure is that it's nearly always successful unless there's some misalignment that's got the vertebrae out of alignment. If there is, it's well to go to a chiropractor and get it in alignment and then do this to yourselves or have someone do it for you. And it's instantaneous relief of pain. Just be a little careful with it for a day or two because we're also creating an energy field that'll continue the healing until it's totally perfect. All right, Dent, that should be complete.
Thank you, Frank. Thank you, group.
Do we have anything else coming in, JP?
Well, we've got a new chat room, but no healing request as yet. But we'll see what happens. Well, I was just going to say, it feels like I got a pinched nerve in my back. So that one just did that. So I might as well go home. No, I am home. Here I am in my home. I don't know if there's anybody else in the chat room. If you want to ask for a healing request, please type in capital letters into the chat room and we'll relay that to Frank and the team. Well, Frank, do you have any, what's been your, this week has, in your healing practice, what issues have come up? Have you had any recurrent themes?
I just trying to remember one that was pretty.
Memory loss?
Yeah, I'm here.
Memory loss?
No. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
All right. I was trying to remember. See, when I get into this state, I can't remember my physical reality very well. But I'm sure it'll come back sometime. Other than that, oh, golly, I can't think. These things come when I release them. They're done and gone, and it's hard to bring it back.
But no recurrent themes this week in your healings.
Let's see. Oh, darn. I had one that I was really going to remember, too. Well, let's direct some energy to my brother in La Grande, Oregon, and his wife. She's been in the hospital. And we work with her occasionally. But all the time, I've prompted Dawn with the realization that the medication she's on is what is causing most of her physical problems, loss of memory and everything else, and almost Alzheimer's. And so she got so bad this week, they took her to the hospital and got a new doctor, and they changed the medications, and she's doing a lot better now. And while she was there, I did some intense healing on what the medications had done to her system, the improper meditations. Over-medicating can be as dangerous as under-medicating. And so we have to clear out the frequency patterns of whatever the residue that is in the system. And it's really interesting. A lot of times when I scan people, if I suspect there's something in their past medicating, I'll look at it and get them to recite the list of the things that they've taken in the past. And as soon as they mention something, if they still have it in their system, I can feel it. And so we just go in and deprogram that energetically, just break it down and clear it. One of the good things we worked with this week, which we did yesterday also in the Earthmind group or the World Healers group working with Earthmind, is in working with Rachel, who had a really severe flu a couple of weeks ago or 3 weeks. She just couldn't get over the dark, heavy feeling of having that flu. And one of her psychic friends told her what she's really suffering from was the miasma of the flu, whatever it was, that particular bug. And so when I worked with her, I tuned into her and I could feel it. It was just like, almost like a depressive energy just pulling her down, just clogging everything up. And it wasn't that she still had the active live virus or bug in her. It was the group mind consciousness of the virus that was in attunement with all the other viruses out there in the community that sustained this morphogenic field of that particular virus, sharing the life force of whoever they were saprophytically sucking energy from at that time. So went into her and cleared that, and within minutes she felt fine. And you're still doing well, aren't you, Rachel?
I felt so good after, but I am feeling a little bit of burning again, so I'm not quite sure what that is. But, I mean, when you were doing the clearing, I literally felt it leave my body. But today I am feeling a little bit of... It's the lower body, like a little burning.
Okay.
So.
I'm just going to drop in and fix that right now.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, that's the survival consciousness of the organism. There we go. Okay, that should help. But the beauty of it was, is spinning off of that and realization about the communal consciousness of morphogenic fields of organisms, no matter what it is, chicken pox or measles or viruses like flus and things of that nature, when it gets endemic, it becomes a force of consciousness out there that weakens the perspective clients, patients, or victims, and it's easy for it to take over, and it mutates in direct proportion to whatever is needed to keep the thing growing and evolving, and it resonates its new mutation that it is required to meet whatever the threat is to its life vitality. And the sustenance of the morphogenic field. So we springboarded off of that awareness, and went to Africa and worked on the Ebola virus. And so it's going to be interesting to see, because the group mind conscious of humans is so in fear of that now, it's really is what's causing the endemic. So as they flee outward to escape it, they carry the virus with them and keep it mutating and going on. But we'll see within a week here if it starts to calm down or not. It'll take longer than that thing. It'll take probably a couple of months to really be able to tell if we're effective or not.
My feeling is a lot of this is a mind virus. It's a fear virus. It's not really an actual physical germ, but actually more of a fear injection that makes everybody ill and stresses everybody, which makes them ill.
Exactly.
Frank, this is Dent again, and I don't know if anyone else in the group has been feeling this, but I've been having really low energy for the last, I don't know, couple of weeks. And I seem that I'm just tired all the time, and I'm in really good health, and I don't have any anything to complain about other than
I can tell you exactly what it is, Dent, and everybody is experiencing it. It's the photon belt that we're moving into.
That's what I thought.
If you're not coming up to speed, opening up your channels to let that in, it will weaken you.
I have been. I think I have been. I've been accepting and opening my third eye and utilizing the energies to.
Okay. Well, what it's doing, it's clearing and breaking loose a lot of old patterns and forms that you're unaware of, and that's what the density, the down, tired feeling is. Is you need to work on clearing the stuff that it's breaking loose and clearing. Do your chakra clearing.
Okay, I haven't been doing that regularly recently. I utilize it quite a bit, and I haven't been recently, so I'll do that. Thank you.
Yeah, if I could write a prescription for everybody in the world for good health and vitality and progression in life and in spirituality, this prescription would read, do your chakra clearing twice daily. In the morning to clear what you may have accumulated in your travels at night, and in the evening before you go to bed.
Well, that's what I'm going to do. Thanks, Frank.
All right. We have a healing request from Kim Code, Renfrew, Canada, pulled muscles in shoulders and upper back. All right, Kim. First thing, you've got so much spasm there that you're actually distorting your spine, and that's causing a pinching sensation on your the pain. All right, we're going to put a column of energy right down from the base of your brain now, down your spine, all the way down to your sacrum. This column of energy is bringing everything back into alignment, and it would help if you would move around, and as this loosens up the spasms in your back, just gently rotate your upper body and the mid body and feel as these things come back into place, because we're allowing that to happen now. And I'm feeling an intense energy coming out of my hands that's allowing this to happen. Get that one right up. Yeah, right there. Okay, good. Now, the pulled muscles, there's some inflammation, and this is necessary in order for the muscles to heal themselves. We're putting a flow of energy in right now to reduce the spasm, to reduce the inflammation. Through the power of the Christ within us, we see this neck and back in the perfect and normal condition. Now, Kim, begin to just gently move your, rotate your head back and forth, just in the flat plane now, until you can't feel any more tension down your neck as you rotate back and forth. Uh, right now, just relax your head to the left. Just let it drop over to your shoulder. As we lengthen, take the stress out of those muscles on the right side. And anyone else out there who is listening and having similar problems, you can do this too. There, that's it. Now bring your head back upright and let it run the right shoulder. Feel it. Feel the muscles lengthening all the way down your back and in the shoulders. Now just gently with your hand or your lower arm closed in towards your body, put your right elbow right straight out and just gently rotate now. Feel that come back into place as the muscles relax. Okay. Now do that on the left side. Okay, now you should feel much better. We'll wrap an energy field around there to continue the healing. Okay. Do we have Kent available yet?
Do you mean Kyle?
Kyle, yeah.
No, he won't be able to be here till closer to 7 because he's working. He's coming right from work.
The plan was to do it during the Stellar Group.
Correct? Well, I wanted to give this to everyone else out there, though.
Oh, yeah.
Well, we'll wait and see if he comes in at the last. JP, if we have to run over into the next hour, is that a possibility? Because we're going.
We have schedules with Revolution Radio. We can't. So we're stuck to the hour. So. It'll be stellar if it's stellar. So let's see how it goes.
All right.
Well, we can run over on UMR.
I have a question, Frank. When you were talking about releasing the, I forgot what it was, whether it was the memory of the virus with Rachel.
Mm-hmm.
And you said, oh, just a moment, and then you became very, very quiet. I'm very curious as to how you released that, and I'm sure there are others that would be happy to learn that as well.
Well, Rachel just came on and said, all the burning in my lower body is gone. So let's let her tell you how we did it. Rachel?
Well, when we initially did the healing and he was clearing out that morphogenic field, I literally could feel like all these particles move out of my body, just like just clearing out until you couldn't even feel it anymore. It was gone. And it's interesting what you just shared with me, Frank, because I could feel some of it coming back and you said, oh, that's the survival stuff. So could you explain that? Like there was a part of me in survival? Because I can feel it gone again. It is just gone.
Well, it's survival of the organism more than you.
Ah.
It's life is very tenuous, you know. It'll hang on. Even if there's really only one viable organism left in your body, it would have the capability of regenerating that morphogenic field because all the rest of the fields out in the neighborhood contribute energy to it to bring it back again. So that's what was happened. So after we do these clearings, we do well to repeat it daily for a few days to make dang sure we get every last one of them.
I remember you once did a Book of the Dead for the viruses too. So I did that yesterday. Or was it today? I can't recall the timing. But isn't that something we can also do, too, just to send them?
Yeah, that's what we did with the Ebola virus too.
Yeah.
Is send them back to the right and proper field and, where they can evolve and do their thing without having to be parasitic on people. To answer your question more thoroughly, Teresa, you remember how I explained where you have your point of attention? That's where you're in full resonance, if you have clarity. And so when I put my attention on Rachel, it's just like I'm her. I'm looking at her eyes. I feel everything in her body and immediately picked up that energy that is in her lower body. And it's just like pushing it out. That's the only way I can explain it. Remember, we create the torus out in front, and I just move it out. It's just like telling it, you have no right or permission or authority to be here. And sometimes we actually talk to it that way, too. But viruses are very subjective. They will respond. And we can be, well, Dent, for example, he carried, what's the name of that thing you had, Dent? You couldn't get rid of?
Hepatitis C.
Yeah. Well, I worked with him once or twice, 2 years ago or so now?
2 years ago, once, yeah, really. Twice, actually, once on the radio program, when I didn't know it was just a recording, and then once on the phone.
Yeah. And there's been no return of it, is there?
No, it's completely healed since then from it. It was it's miraculous. I was stunned.
Well, you can call them miracles if you want to, but really, it's all within our potential and power to do this. Any of us can do this.
Right, I got that.
And it's your self-awareness, number one, the recognition that it's possible.
Oh, yeah.
And assimilating that into, this is the answer to your question, Teresa. Assimilating that pure inner knowing in yourself, so it's just a fact. There's absolutely no doubt
that
you can do this. And by assimilating that in there and then picking up the resonance of the organism, whatever it is, which you just simply do, putting your name, mere attention on the frequency and feel it in your own system, where your own system is responding to that, picking up that frequency. And then you just will into that morphogenic field that it either pulled back out of you or out of the person we're working with or anyone else, that it you do not give it permission to be in your system. It's like, just like I constantly stress, creating your reality instead of being subjective to it. And this is mastery. When you master yourself, you master everything outside of yourself as well. So being a master is nothing more and as simple as mastering yourself, your own reality. And this is the training field that we're in now and have been for some time, thousands of years. And this is what the fourth dimension is all about, is acknowledging within ourselves that these things are possible and getting some direction, some help, either intuitively or from someone who knows how to do it, and simply becoming an extension of the God Force consciousness that manifested this in the first place. If being that aspect of the God Force consciousness resides in your heart, in your zero point, if it can hold your whole physical body in reality and hold everything, just holds the patterns of everything that goes wrong with it in reality, then it can also create the positive clarity of not having it there, of releasing it. It's as simple as how it works.
I think that's why people get so confused, because they think it's harder than how you explained. So initially we have to master our thoughts. And that's what makes it simple, is after we master our thoughts, meaning that don't allow your thought to think that it cannot be, because it is.
The more simple you allow, and understanding the physics of what how it works, that's critical too, because it's not just like doing an affirmation, you know, like some of the spiritual groups, where they try make long-winded affirmations and then pound it into the subconscious, trying to make it happen by repeating it 40 times. That just confuses the subconscious. The subconscious only responds to two things. What is it? And what do you want to do with it? And the simpler you can make your affirmation, the better it works. Pain, go. With a burst of energy, you have to supply the energy. Not enough just to mouth the intent. You have to put a burst of pure heart, soul, how can I describe it?
I use the word love.
Force of consciousness, which is love.
Perhaps that's why people do the affirmations, because that's their way of controlling their thoughts, but they don't know the rest of the steps to take.
Oh, I remember now. It's just the science of mind. I looked into that a little bit when I was first, and all it did is distract me from the fact that I could just do it anyway. I didn't have to do all that affirmation stuff every day. We have a request from Colleen. Okay. Healing for her mother, Mamie Morose, in Harold Heal, Essex, UK, 83 years old, able to walk with an aid, but twisted her left knee in the swimming bath a couple of weeks ago, has been given a steroid injection, but still has pain. Okay. All right, Colleen, we're going to go through you to do this. Now, first we tune in to Colleen. Just open up to us. You're already with us. Okay, Colleen, now we have you. Put your thoughts on your mother now. Just put your whole attention on her. Just
It's Peter's mother, but we can still do this. It's Peter's mother who's requested, and Colleen's relayed the request from Peter. But we can still go through Colleen and through Peter to Mimi Moroz in Harold Hill.
Okay, well, that wasn't explained. Okay, Colleen. Okay, we're feeling her left knee now. As soon as you drop into the mother, you feel in your knee what her problem is. Just straighten that knee out, right? Straight forward as much as you can. You have to slide down in your chair to do it. Do that. Get that knee straight and in alignment. Okay, there's some torn tissue and collagen there. All right, we create a field circulating. Again, it's that same green field from right to left. Over the top of her knee, that's... Now we're bringing in the intent. And we state our intent through the power of the Christ within us. We see Mother's knee in the perfect and normal condition. We see the tissues being regenerated and healed. We see the regeneration of the worn cartilage in the knee, the inflammation. Now every one of you out there can feel this. Feel it happening in her knee. Now it's getting a little hot, and that's good. That's regeneration of tissues. Instead, I have my hands turned toward my left knee as I'm doing this, and that helps. And feel the energy just pour out of my hands into my knee and right directly into her, because we're in full resonance now through Colleen. Now wiggle your toe back and forth. Get everything there. Yeah. Back into alignment. Now it feels good. Now we change the rotation, and it's like wrapping a plaster cast around the outside of the green energy, going clockwise, looking down at it, going clockwise. It's the opposite polarity, and this is coming out of your left hand. In fact, I use my right hand in a circular motion to wrap it around that knee. Now it's firming up. See, it's, you created the form, put the energy in it. Now it has to solidify into manifestation. Okay. All right, she should be fine now. These are usually instantaneous. Just be careful with it for a few days. Okay, Mike. Do you want us to work with you now, Mike?
Sure, whenever it's convenient. I'm not picky.
Okay. All right. Mike just wants a general revitalization of his whole system. He's been fighting the big C now for months. We don't give it a name so as not to stimulate the subconscious mind to bring it back, but we just call it the condition. And so we just focus our attention on Mike. And just open our awareness through his entire system. And Mike is clear. He's learned how to keep himself clear of negative invasive forces. So it's safe to do this. All right, now I'm being shown, Mike, that every human has a template of perfection. This template is held in the oversoul male polarity realm of consciousness, in the oversoul octaves. And with you in our minds, we're reaching up to our own oversoul, and through our unified oversouls, we're bringing that template back into form that has broken down in youth over the years of self-abuse. And through the oversoul, we're dropping that template down out through your crown chakra, down into your system. We're feeling your DNA respond. And where the DNA had become subjective to so much of the negative reality you lived and worked in, we're bringing back the pure and perfect condition. This is the template. This is you without the operation even though we know we have to physically get along with the operation. We're seeing that entire situation clearing up now, no further negative conditions. But we're in the template, we're acknowledging the operation and the beneficent use of it while we, when we needed it. And we just hold this in the zero point of our heart until we feel the release of the negative condition, the negative template that grew. There, now you see, Mike, it's getting lighter. This means you feel that glow. That's the positive template coming back in that you've been asking for all this time. Now, you're ready for it now. Now we reach down through the low self into earth mind, into the negative polarity, and pull up the resonance of the biological needs, the physical needs. Just bring that back up through the spine to fill it. Fill the formulation of the template with the pure and perfect condition. Do this for your entire body, all the way up to the top of your head, to bring back your vigor, vitality, healing through the power of the Christ within us. We bring Mike into the pure and perfect condition through the zero point to come into full manifestation and healing now. Yeah, after all these trials that you've been through for the last year and a half, you no longer have any lessons to learn. You're here, you've arrived, and you've stepped ahead lifetimes in your spiritual growth. Through the power of the Christ in us, we all welcome Mike into the full, complete brotherhood of man. Throw off the chemo. Now there's the miasma I was talking about. Release the chemo now. The effect it's had on the rest of the system. Okay, Mike, now within yourself, know it's done.
I'm going to ask if Rachel can give a tone for the chemo to eradicate itself out, whatever residual.
Okay, and I want to share because I saw a visual of these black rock-like things coming out. As soon as he mentioned that, I saw all these black rocks literally coming out of his body. So I'm going to bring a tone in for more clearing.
Perfect.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think you cleared the wax in your left ear, too.
Oh, maybe all down, maybe all the way down to my left ankle.
Yeah, oh, it's incredible. When she hits her notes, thought fields and patterns just move, and everything is solid anyway. And so
it's a good thing I didn't have any crystal glassware around here. It'd be like it's shattering all over the place.
Yeah. Okay, how do you feel?
I feel calm. I feel calm sense of kind of happiness and contentment. I feel my confidence building. So I feel good.
Perfect. Okay. It does feel better.
I would like to add a little thing here. Rachel, you have an incredible voice. And I've got a little machine that does some amazing things. It's called a theremin. Have you heard of theremin, Frank?
No.
It's the oldest electronic musical instrument ever. I've been playing with it for the last few days. I built one a few years ago. And everybody will know what it sounds like. You all know the sound because it was used in movies, monster movies, to get that eerie feeling. But you can use it as a healing sweep instrument. Let me, if you mind, don't mind, I can demonstrate, and it will give you a very similar thing to what Rachel was giving us.
Please,
please.
So,
it needs a bit of calibrating sometimes.
Sure, it's not a 747.
Yeah. There we go. And a soft, give it a soft one. It's not behaving very well tonight.
Normally it can get a lot smoother than that, but it was, as I said, it was trying to sound like a jumbo jet. But you can get all sorts of interesting effects from it. But I've been letting my friends just play with it because it gives you the tones that you need. Like it will sweep past the tones. It's like somebody going, ooh, all over you.
Well, what happens? Does it work?
It certainly has made everybody feel more relaxed.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, that's
I'll put my nickel in Rachel's machine.
Well, Rachel's it's done with love. Hers comes from the love within herself, and it machines have not been able to figure that one out yet.
Well, and she's in resonance with the problem too.
Very true. Maybe the machine will be when we all figure out how to do the love within, and then the vibration will be like the tuning fork, toning fork.
I think I've seen one of these. Isn't that the thing you move your hands up around a couple of rods or something? And
that's right. It's like the old days when you were tuning your radio.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
You could hear radio-like sounds. But it's to do with literally how far away my hand is from this antenna, but you've got to tune it right. I tried tuning it earlier, but in the meantime, the battery went flat and so it went out of tune, so it wasn't at its best.
Well, the thing would be for you as the healer to be resonating through your hands the exact frequency that you want, that you know you have to have, rather than just shotgunning us all those tones. Hit the exact frequency and let it amplify it with your intent through it. Then it could work.
Oh, Frank, I wanted to tell you that Kyle is here.
Okay.
Well,
we have 8 minutes. We can do this.
Okay.
And then we'll carry it on over into the Stellar group also, because I want people to know about this, how this works. I Jane and I were up in La Grande, Oregon, and on one of our tours, and a young fellow came to us about 23 years old, and he's on dialysis and had been for like 6 months. His kidneys is totally shot. And so I wanted to know if we could help him. And we were just starting out as healers. I didn't know if I could or not. So what I did was I did healing directly on his kidneys and cleared the mental emotional cause, which was his mother. And he was pissed off at her all the time. And that's what was causing the problem. And that's how it expressed was out through his kidneys. And anyhow, the inspiration hit me because we'd been working with charged water at that time. I told him to go out and bring back 7 gallons of pure water. And he did. And we about 4 of us sat around and with our hands around these water containers, these gallons of, in plastic jugs. And we channel this healing energy into those jugs. Now, as we did that, our hands got incredibly hot, just like my hands are getting hot at this moment, just thinking about it. And we'd probably spent 5 minutes just pouring energy into these things. And I told him to drink a glass of it every day or something like that, and we'd be back in a month. Well, when we came back the next month, expecting him to show up for another treatment, and his best friend showed up and brought us the empty jugs or the jugs full of water. And he said, would we please charge him up again? Because the kid had been off of dialysis for 2 weeks. Apparently he was totally healed. And the kid had, because he could, he had gone fishing and he sent his jugs for a revitalization. So we very joyfully charged up his water again, and I've never heard of him since. So we know this works. And so, all right. Do you have those jugs of water that I requested you to get, Jackie?
Yes, I do.
All right. I want you to put your hands about an inch from them, as many of them as you can, realizing that... And I want the entire group consciousness of everyone out there now to visualize, what's his name again?
Kyle.
We're visualizing Kyle and the fact that he's on dialysis and has other problems too. We're just going to put total healing now into this water. And we feel it happening already. We're creating a field of energy around all those jugs, even the ones you don't have in your hands around. Through the power of the Christ within us, we see Kyle in the perfect and normal condition. And we pour the group mind consciousness energy. We feel the galactic flow just pouring down through our systems and through the zero point, out of our hands, into these jugs. And into Kyle, I have my hands on each side of Kyle's back and his kidneys now, stimulating these to pure and perfect condition. All right, Kyle, I want you to throw off the mental emotional cause for this condition. The negative self-perception you felt in your childhood, it just is not important. It does not exist. Clear it all out of your system. You're a good, beautiful, honorable person, regardless of what your genetic programming is. Let it all go. Clear it out now. Be all you can be in this lifetime, because you've got one shot at it in this lifetime. I'm moving my hands up now around your body, lifting those negative programs right out of your system, right up through the top of your head, casting to the side, actually doing what you call therapeutic touch on you to clear you now. Through the power of the Christ within us, we clear Kyle, release. Now he can be receptive to some beautiful healing energy coming in.
Blow the oxygen out of your mouth. Blow it out. Blow.
Okay.
And breathe in the love that we are sending, the healing love that we are sending to you, surrounding you with.
Kyle, your whole body should be getting hot now. Is it?
Yes.
Yeah, I thought so. Every system in your body is correcting itself now. Let go. I suspect you have diabetes too, don't you?
No.
No? No diabetes? All right. That's good. That makes it easier. Did I understand, Jackie, to say you were going blind?
No.
Oh, okay.
I hope not.
Sorry about that. Well, you're going to be a lot easier to fix than I thought you were. So. All right, just feel this energy point in and through you now. And we're going to go off the air in a minute, but we're going to just continue doing this because we'll be on our own show. Anyone that's interested, I think, can go to our the World Healing. What is it?
Universal Mind Radio. Yep.
Universal Mind Radio, and we'll just continue.
Okay. We can keep broadcasting on Universal Mind Radio.
Thank you, JP.
Good night, everybody.
Good night, JP.
Good night, JP.
Good night, everybody. Good night.
Okay.
Okay, loves. Good night.
Good night.
Thank you. Good night.
All right, we're on our own turf here now.
The laughter was the best.
All right, Kyle, what are you feeling?
He may have dropped off. I saw Dent dropped off.
Oh, he was with Ned? I thought he was with Jackie.
Oh.
Jackie, are you there?
Did they think we were going to go to Stellar?
I don't know. But,
I feel that he's holding on to some residual, and I can't figure out where he's keeping it in his body.
Oh, there's Dent coming back.
Okay, we shut off the thing thinking we were getting called back. Should we stay on this line?
Yeah.
Okay, sorry. So unprofessional. We're so unprofessional.
Okay, Kyle, we're still pouring energy into you. This is from the group. I think we're still connected into the larger extended group, too, because there's a tremendous amount of energy coming through.
Yeah, and there's five of us here, and we're really focusing hard on this.
Do each one of you have a gallon of water?
No, we're grabbing one now.
We're grabbing one. We got them all together.
All right, water is a liquid crystal, and it holds energy frequency just like a quartz crystal does. That's how our body communicates, is through the liquid crystal between the cell groups and organs and whatnot. All right, I'm really going to focus now on, I'm going into your head, into the thing that controls the kidneys and the renal function. All right, Catherine, that's what you were talking about.
I am just burning up right now, Frank, so wherever you are, it's where you're supposed to be.
Now, Kyle, you believe with all your heart and soul that this is happening?
Yes.
the power of the Christ within us. We see Kyle in the perfect and normal condition. We're working in the zero point in your heart. And we want to clear and release from the standing ways of your past everything, every memory, every experience of being on dialysis or your kidneys breaking down. We're breaking that down in the standing waves of your past.
Kyle, put your hands on your heart, palms, and just keep deep breathing.
We're breaking down your past now, so there's nothing back there to maintain this condition. And we're bringing it up to the zero point where everything collapses anyway. Now from this moment of now, resonating forward, your condition does not exist. Project that into your future and
flick your hands out. Flick your fingers. Flick. Just flick.
Yeah, you're flicking away the past when you do that. Now, all of us are looking into your future, seeing you in the perfect and normal condition, having a happy life, a productive life, doing whatever you're capable of doing in life. Creating your reality instead of being subjective to it.
Breathe in that truth. Take a deep breath in to your diaphragm. And just feel that truth course through your whole body. And know that this is.
Now you feel a light blowing in your heart. That is the spirit center, your God force consciousness. It's actively creating in the zero point your new reality. So just let that expand out through your entire body, that light, until you're just filled with light.
Ah, he has a beautiful light about him.
Yes, he does. Now that he's got all the garbage cleared off and he can let his light shine through.
And I'm laughing because you were blushing and the light turned blush.
I feel different. I was exhausted when I came over here.
You were exhausted?
Yeah.
You feel a little better?
Yeah. Yeah, just all I wanted to do was go lay down.
Oh, you have a great voice, my friend.
Thank you.
And everybody in the room was crying. It was just very, very moving.
That's the water.
It's the water.
Okay.
Should I get the crystals that I was going to put in three of the jugs?
Yeah.
We just put our hands on the jugs when we told you recently. Is that, do we need to do anything else with the crystal, with the water?
Well, the crystals will help hold the frequency in the water. Well, what that does is if you run out of water and need to charge up another bottle, you simply put the crystal in there and it'll charge the next bottle for you.
Oh, did you hear that? What? After you drink a bottle of the water, I've got three crystals and I'm charging those. And they're going to hold the charge.
Of healing.
And when you're done with the bottle, take the crystal out and put it in another bottle because I only have three.
Oh, okay.
Make sure the one you're drinking out has a crystal.
Make sure it has one in.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
We'll try and get some more crystals.
And Frank, how much water does he drink out of each bottle a day?
Well, if he's capable of charging his, let's see, if he drank a, Let's see. What have you got? Five bottles?
Six.
How many cups is that? 16. Divide that by 30.
Seven.
Seven jugs.
Seven glasses a day?
No, seven jugs. We have seven jugs of water.
Oh, okay. Times four quarts. That'd be eight cups. If you do four cups a day, that'll carry you for 14 days. I think I got that right.
And drink more water other than, but this is like your healing water, but do drink other water throughout the day too.
Yeah.
Four cups a day.
Oh man, I feel so good.
This young man has had to be in hell with this dialysis for 10 years. It's ridiculous. And my daughter helps him so much, and their whole family is impacted.
And that's a thing of the past. So we don't need to bring that forward with us. In emotions, we know it in lessons learned and what you went through, but we don't need that emotion anymore.
Yeah, you wouldn't have held on this long if you hadn't been keeping yourself clear for a purpose. So it's what you do with your life from now on is what's important. It could be something just as simple as being able to do this for other people who need dialysis. Being able to charge the water up yourself, because every healing is a spiritual experience, and virtually every person I've ever worked with and done these truly miraculous so-called healings, they've been able to do it too. It's like a translation from one person to another, reprogramming. And so it wouldn't surprise me, Kyle, if you can charge up healing water for others and help them too with their problems.
And when you go home, you will take the light and the healing with you. And when you tell everyone at home what happened, it'll resonate and just spread it out. And so once you walk in your house, that light will be there and the jugs will be there, and it'll just change the whole atmosphere. And so it is.
So we're going to have him drink a glass of water now.
Okay.
It's an interesting thing. When you do this healing on water, it changes the structure of the water. It tastes like it goes flat.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it does taste different.
Already distilled.
My Shingite water tastes different, Frank.
Yeah.
But now that I think of that, I'm going, yeah, the water that I had, the Shingite, tastes different.
Does it? Well, I'll play with that too. I used to have a lot of fun with people, and if they were drinking a Coke or something, I'd tell them to take a taste of it and really remember how the Coke tastes. And I'd put my hands around it for 20-30 seconds or so and channel healing energy into it and then hand it back to them and just be totally flat. They wouldn't even want to drink it, the rest of it.
Bad Frank.
Well, one of the amazing things about structured water is water that's destructured or, you know, has been beaten up by water pipes or pollution or radiation, when it's structured, it becomes, it goes back to its pure geometric forms. And the reason that structured water is so wonderful is that the little tubules on the cells that allow, water to go in are shaped in a geometric shape. And so when the water is structured and it has the geometry, it matches those little tubules and they go into it and truly hydrate the cells. Whereas if it's destructured, you can have a fire hose you know, trying to water yourself with a fire hose, and that water won't go in. And so it is naturally a healing water when it is structured. So you've got that plus the additional recipe of love and healing. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Teresa, you have such a healing voice. You know, when you speak, it's like healing's going on. I love it.
Teresa, would you mind just telling me one more time, this is Jackie, what structured is?
Structured water is water which is, it returns back to its natural geometric form. And destructured water is, doesn't have that form. So it's the geometry, the sacred geometry.
The crystalline shape of the water.
The crystalline shape of the water?
I would think so. It returns to its natural intent of what God intended. And it loves the zigzaggy activity of, let's say, for example, down a stream, a mountain stream, and it appears to go around rocks and, you know, and plants and things like that. And so that chaos movement actually restructures it. So if you want to just take tap water and you want to restructure it, or distilled water and restructure it, if you take... do you know what a Brita filter is?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. Get a used Brita filter, cut the lid off, shake out the carbon, and throw in a bunch of crystals in where the carbon was, and then just pour water through it. And that chaotic kind of dance will restructure the water as it comes through it. And also it has the added feature of the little silver screens at the bottom. And silver is a natural bacteria neutralizer. It'll kill bacteria. It has a frequency that'll kill bacteria.
Thank you. I never heard of that.
Once. Yeah, you can use marbles or crystals and anything to get the water to dance around it and thrust it through it.
I've seen the... I've seen water molecules that were looked at under a heavy microscope prior to being blessed, and it shows their crystalline shapes, which are very minimal. And then after they've been blessed, it shows the same water molecules under this heavy microscope, and they were just alive and hugely different. And it was always, it amazed me to see that just the blessing of water molecules would change them so drastically.
Are we still on?
Yep. Yes, we are. I'm just sitting here marveling on how this healing for Kyle just is making my heart center feel fabulous.
Thank you, Kathleen.
Well, I'm going to say thank you to Kyle for mm-hmm. being who he is, so I got to do this. Thank you.
No, well, thank you.
Yes, thank you from New Zealand too, Kyle. It's beautiful. Yeah.
I feel the warm heart glow. It's just absolutely beautiful.
Well, you know, we're raising the consciousness of our own healing group here to the point where we can virtually take on any healing thing now and know we can do it.
Isn't that a great feeling, Frank? Or knowing, I guess is a better way to say.
Yeah. It's interesting because the very first person I healed over 35 years ago now, I just knew I could do it. And as I went through all the various different things, the degree that it could be done, it was more in my awareness of what needed to be done and the clarity and receptivity of the person doing it. So now it's becoming very clear that if we believe, we can do.
Yeah, that was powerful what you did tonight around the schools, and it was really powerful. Gave me many ideas of what we can do.
Mm-hmm.
I just have a beautiful glass bottle of water in front of me, and I've also put the healing intent in it, and I just douse to see if this water is appropriate for me, and it said yes, and I don't have 7 jugs handy, so I asked the question, if I simply add to this water, will it turn that water, the new additional water, into the healing water of the same potency? And I'm getting yes.
Yes, if you put your intent with it every time you do it and just add a little more energy to it.
Mm-hmm.
Direct the photonic energy into it. That would be a great experiment. Mm-hmm. And see what happens. Let us know.
Because
mm-hmm. that's available all around us. It's just a matter of getting it focused and letting it know what we want it to do. And that's what the galactic flow is doing, is putting the form into the system, responding to our desire and will and our intent. And that's what is focusing the photon energy and make it actually do manifestation. And I think we're unlimited in what we can do with that also, as we gain more awareness, knowledge, and ability.
It does feel like the photon belt, what you said to Dan, I can relate to too, is it is clearing us out.
Mm-hmm.
There's that clearing process going on.
Well, and every time we bring the galactic flow through, it, you know, audibly, it intensifies, and I always feel incredible when we do that.
Yeah, I'm just smiling so big.
It feels like, you know, as we're going through this, at least for me, it's a wave. I kind of go down when it's coming in, and I'm clear, and then it clears out, and then I go back up, and then something else comes, and then it goes up and down.
As you're going with the flow.
Yeah. Which is what I'm supposed to be doing.
Also, that healing for Mike tonight was like no other that I felt. Like, it was powerful for him. And I saw so much energy coming out of his body. I saw it.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Rachel. Thank you.
It was very awesome.
Yeah, he's learned all he needs to out of the disease. He can let it go now.
Yeah, I felt it. Wow. Wonderful.
It's curious on why we keep little residual parts of things that we should be getting rid of. But it's almost like, you know, when you're a little kid and you have a teddy bear and you don't want to give it up.
But part of it, I think it was serving, because there was learning and growth going on. It's part of the evolutionary process. And so once you get it and it's cleared, it's gone. But it served. It was part of the healing process.
Yeah,
Yvonne, if I may ask you, are you using our techniques over there in your work, or what do you do?
Well, yours is new, so I'm incorporating what I'm learning here. That's why I don't have a lot to say, because what you do is new. So, what is it that I work with? I'm just aware of the bodies that need help. For the person, I mean, that's what I consciously do, but then, you know, it takes its own, you just stand in love and in service and in not really knowing, and I suppose what comes through is perfect. So I've had a very lovely teacher in India. He's a medical doctor, but he's also a great spiritual healer. He's almost 80 now. So I've sat with him and worked with him, and I think, and what he says to me is that, we each sort of integrate it into our personality thumbprint, and he says that I work very much in the feminine, in that I work very much, I don't believe in using any force, and I believe a lot in free will, and that there has to be permission to treat the person. But he works a little differently, in that if he feels healing's needed, he just goes ahead and commands it. But it's all perfect. I mean, obviously the ones that need that go and see him, and the ones that need what I have to offer come and see me. So, so I'm really enjoying this new information, and I suppose more than anything else, the healing that I've been receiving from your group and from you, Frank. I feel that will be integrated, there's definitely a greater amount of light and love, and with that, I'm feeling more than I've ever felt, and so that's sort of new territory that I'm stepping into, in just being with feeling more. So, so it's quite a delightful dance, really. Thank you.
I sensed that when I first touched into you, or when I invited you into the group, that you are what I'd term a radiant healer. You just radiate your pure intent and desire to be of service to everyone around you, and they just respond to it. They can't help it, because you're like a radiant beacon of light, and I just love that.
I was just going to say, Yvonne, that as you were talking so forth, I was honing in on your light in New Zealand, and it is just straight up. And to me, it's like a white light, then it goes yellow into pink, and I know that it changes color each time, but I can see your beacon of light, and I thank you for being where you are, because it's the connect for me to our planet, because you are so there. So thank you very much for allowing me to do that.
She's actually in New Zealand.
Yeah, New Zealand. I don't know what did I say, Australia?
England.
Oh, England. Oh, silly me.
She came from England, or from Ireland.
Well, I still see the light. Mm-hmm. And it's there.
Thank you. Thank you.
Frank, I've got a question. When we were talking about water, we had a friend of ours who was, he would kind of mine over in southeastern Idaho. And, he found this one stream, and he gave this jug of water to Glenn and I, and he had actually analyzed it and had people use it, and it did clearing. It healed the water, you know, and this was the first time we ever came across with healing water.
Mm-hmm.
And he was giving it to all sorts of people, and their conditions were clearing up, and he gave us actually, what was it, about an 8-ounce bottle of it. And before, when we moved, and that was in 93 that we moved up here, I still have a container of that water. And he said, you know, all you can, you know, use it up, but leave some of it there. Mm-hmm. And just add more to it because it will permeate the water that you add to it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I believe it. That's the power of creative thought.
Yeah. And I'm going, this was really interesting that, you know, the spring that he found, you know, was kind of like, he was calling it kind of like the fountain of youth because it seemed like it cleared, you know, it healed everything. And that was way back in the 90s.
I have something like that too, Susan. It was given to me years ago from John of God. And all you need is a little bit and you can pass it around to other people if they have a water bottle. So the vibration's all in there. And so then what I do is I'll just take and put a few drops like in my swimming pool or the lake that I walk around. And that vibration goes out everywhere. You can put a little bit in the ocean and it will touch the whole earth.
It's been sitting there in my cabinet for, since 93. I'm going, I should really do something with this. And it's buried back there. And I'm going, I need to do something with this. So I will take that out and see what happens. Cause I'm sure, you know, seeing how what it is, I'm sure it's still good. I don't see why not.
Share the intent of that water with the water behind Catherine and in Kyle's jugs and to all of us as liquid crystals and you too, Rachel.
Yeah.
I think Kyle's jugs has got the equivalent of 100,000 gallons of intent.
high test.
Yeah. it's high octane. Yes. It's high. It's high energy water. Yes.
I can still feel the flow going toward Kyle.
Yeah, I can too. We're still working with him. Can you still feel it, Kyle?
Yes.
You're just laying there going, ah.
Yeah, that's because he's got such a soft, easy heart about himself, and that's why it's just going with the flow because it's so good and easy and loving.
Mm-hmm. That's
what I feel. That's true, Catherine.
You know, this, I'm aware that since there's only 8 of us on here, I think we can turn the camera on. Yes. Turn the camera on, Kyle. Let us.
Well, we have an iPad, Frank.
What?
We have an iPad. Didn't we have a problem the other night?
iPads, we don't have. We have to go get, like, the camera itself, and neither Jackie nor I have done that. The Hollywood part of us just doesn't want to do that.
No lights, camera.
Yeah.
So you're broadcasting to the whole universe.
Hello, everybody. We are just in bliss right now.
Yay.
So this is going up on the radio.
That's good, though, because then everybody's going to pick up little glimmers of this love that is so prevalent with everything we're doing and talking about.
Well, we're so high, let's ask Rachel to bring in the galactic flow so we can spread it around the world.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you.
Did someone clink to turn that off?
No, I just was turning my volume up, and then it stopped.
Did you make a sound, a clinking sound?
I think my hand, when it went there, it hit the paper.
Okay.
That was a good night.
Mm-hmm.
It was incredible.
Well, I know I have to stay just totally concentrated on that flow to hold it. The instant my attention shifts, it goes away, and I think that's what happened there, too.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Well, guys, it's been a fun night.
Perfect. Thank you all for being who you are and where you're at, because you made me my job so easy and full of love. Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you again.
Thank you.
A special thanks to all the people who are still listening on Universal Mind Radio. Frank Jordan, yes, and his group, signing off for today. We'll be good back night. Wednesday
good night,
morning.
Good night.
Good night. Nighty-night.
Love you all.
Love you. Bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
That's it for another week. Okay, folks, that was it. Frank Jordan and the Earth Mind Healing Group, or UniversalMindRadio.com, you've been listening to. I hope you all enjoyed it, and come back on Wednesday at 9 a.m. if you can. If not, we got Universal Mind Radio archives on YouTube. You'll go to on the site there, you'll see, click there for YouTube archives. And the today's show will be up on maybe by tomorrow or the next day. It'll be up on YouTube. So if you missed it, you can always get it there. Thanks for tuning in, and good luck, and God bless everybody. I'm going to switch the music back on now. I hope you guys like the music, too. Good night, and take care.